Good afternoon. This is Dr. Walters with a brief vodcast on the work of George Herbert Mead. Mead, like his friend John Dewey, came out of the early 20th century Chicago school. Mead actually published very little, but was a quite popular teacher at the University of Chicago, where his students published his lecture notes as a book called Mind, Self, and Society, a book that later became one of the most influential works in all of American sociology. The influence of German idealism on the work of George Herbert Mead is here dramatically reduced and oversimplified into one basic idea, and that is the idea of a self as it is in mind or spirit, and the self as it appears or as a phenomena that can be empirically received by others. A key idea in the work of Mead is that consciousness and self emerge in a developmental process as children and adults learn to take the role of others and visualize both self and actions through the eyes of, note, significant others, that is, people they really care about, and their anticipated responses. George Herbert Mead was keenly influenced by the work of Charles Cooley, and especially his concept or category of the looking glass self. Each to each, a looking glass reflects the other that doth pass. Not two principal elements are part of Cooley's idea. Cooley articulates that we imagine how we appear to others. We imagine their judgment of that appearance and develop a self-consciousness or self-feeling based on this imagined self. Note, this is in the imagination, and there is no immediate guarantee that this self, as imagined in the eyes of others, bears any empirical relationship to reality, as we see in the cat who imagines himself to be a powerful and vicious lion. As we see our face figure and dress in the glass and are interested in them because they are ours and pleased or otherwise with them as they do or do not answer to what we should like them to be, so in our imagination we perceive in another's mind some thought of our appearance, manners, aims, deeds, character, friends, and so on, and are variously affected by it. In Mind, Self, and Society, George Herbert Mead makes a sharp distinction between non-significant gestures, that is, gestures that appear at the animal level, like growling, significant gestures that are self-conscious at the human level, but not yet language. You'll see this in the short podcast on the two twins' infants interacting. And finally, significant symbols and symbolic interaction, which is the distinctively human form of interaction. The human level of communication arouses in the individual a response called out in the other. It involves the use of symbols, interpretation, and definitions. Mead describes three stages with substages in the child's development. In the first stage, which is again what you see in the film on the infant, is preparatory or sheer mimicry or imitating adults. In the play stage, it's still somewhat limited in that the children play something like a game, but a game with only one or two roles in which they go one step beyond mimicry and articulate more limited roles. In the game stage, this is a fully worked out organizational structure that anticipates the responses of a number of different people in a number of different roles. The famous example of this is the baseball game, in which the child, the emerging child, the emerging adult, can envision the role of multiple others, each of whom is playing a different role. And so it's a complex set of role relationships with rules of the game, and the child or the adult has to figure out and create a response that anticipates what all of these other people will do in response to his or her action. It's probably or might be best to think about this as we think about child development and soccer games. Children who are about 4 may play soccer, but there is absolutely no way that you will ever persuade a 4-year-old to work as the goalie. It's a swarm of children running up and down the field. When they get to the game stage, they can actually understand that different members of the team have different roles and functions, and they can be counted on to do their part. Mead identifies in the game stage what he refers to as the generalized other, or the capacity of the child to envision, and the adult, to envision the entire community or the attitude of an entire team, a team that's composed of discrete individuals, and an entire team or community that allows for or enables the possibility of abstract thinking and objectivity as the individual discerns that different people in the community have different roles and functions. The development of a self requires that the person be directed toward the attitudes of all the others in the game and the rules that govern the entire community. Playing a game requires an integrated and coherent sense of self in relationship to this multiplicity of others, and it is crucial for the development of the capacity of the individual to participate in organized activities, but also for the existence of those organized activities to begin with. A crucial concept in the work of Mead is the idea of the I and the Mead, and this is the one that most reflects the imported ideas of the noumenal and phenomenal selves. The I is the creative actor or actress, never totally aware, but the I initiates action. The me is the vision of the I from the point of view of an internalized set of attitudes and beliefs that are held by others. In a sense, it's similar to Freud's understanding of the superego, but it is the visioning or envisioning of an act or a self from the point of view of all the others in the community. It's an internalized form of social control, but also it's a distinctive human feature in that we can actually envision the attitudes and beliefs of others and their responses to us before we do anything, and then change the course of action or our planned course of action accordingly. For Mead, like Durkheim, the society precedes the individual. It is an ongoing process, and social institutions shape or form the life habits of the community, or, in quotes, the rules of the game. So the social institutions are part of a set of established patterns that are resistant to change and part of the taken-for-granted life habit of the community. They're the family, religion, economic, political, educational, legal, or social control, or health institutions that have enduring patterns that shape the rules of the game or form the underlying structure that guides human interaction, and a set of institutions or set of rules that the individual or new individual, child or adult, entering the community must learn.